Hi, welcome everyone. This is a conversation with Shreyans Gupta. He was part of the crew team that got Jason Reardon across the 5-5-5 finish line last year. So thank you, Shreyans, for joining us.
Thank you, Chetan. Thank you so much for having me.
Before we come to your La Ultra journey, can you just take people through a bit about your running and active background? Where did you start?
So, as a teenager, I never ran. I played a lot of cricket. Once I left college and I started working, that's when I realized that, okay, now I can't spend the amount of time I do on a cricket field. So, that's when I took up gymming, I took up running, and I took up tennis as well. And it was in the process that I realized that, you know what, this distance running is sort of fun. I used to not run so much, 5, 7, 8 kilometers. And then the scene of having the annual marathon in my city, Indore, that had just started. That was about 7 years ago when the first edition of the marathon happened. And I took part in it. And since then, I just got hooked on to it. I was never seriously training distance, but whenever I would run, I would just normally go out, run 8-10 kilometers and just come back home. And that was all that was up until a year ago. And that is when I got in touch with Nakul Bhutta from New Delhi, who I think you very know. And with him, I said to him that, you know what, I want to target this marathon and I want to train properly for it. And that is how I started running more serious, took it more seriously, and I started doing in more amount of kilometers and everything. And yeah, it's been going on since then, and we just run the full marathons. That's what I target. I target marathon races, say one or two a year, and yeah, I just run them.
Great, great. So when did you come to know about La Ultra, and what were your first thoughts when you came to know about the race?
Oh, so Nakul had messaged people in the running group. It was like, there's an excellent volunteering opportunity, and you know, it's in Leh and it's called the La Ultra. I had never heard of it. I had never heard of people doing 111, 222, 333, and then 555K at that altitude, anywhere in that. For that matter, I had not heard that such races even existed. The longest I'd heard was, like, I don't know, some races over like 100-mile races in America or something. I didn't know much about the ultra running scene in India. And Nakul was the one who told us. And he also said very nice things, firstly, about Dr. Rajat Chauhan, the race director, and yourself, that, you know, they are people who themselves are runners. They know what it is. It is not just a race that people are doing for financial gains or something. They know what it is and everything. And, you know, somehow I was like, okay, I really want to see, first of all, how people do this. And secondly, why do they do it? Like, I'm sure, now I've put myself under a marathon and that's a stress enough. But, like, now, why do people even run? Why do people even think about running 100, 200, 300 kilometers was beyond me. And with that intrigue, it is that I signed up to crew. Of course, I was scared. I was like, okay, now I'm sure it's competitive. A lot of people want to do it. So I wasn't sure whether I'll be selected or not. And then I told Nakul, I was like, can you put a word for Chetan? Like, can he please sign me on, get me on board in the La Ultra program? And he spoke to you as well. And then you came back with a very positively towards me. And that's how it started.
So what were your expectations from the crew when you saw that there's an opportunity to come and volunteer? What did you think? What would it really entail?
Okay, so the small flyer that came out in the very beginning was, okay, there would be a crew certification course. You would join a team of runners. Still at this point, I didn't know anybody. For that matter, I also didn't know that there was a person from Nakul's group who was going to race as well, Sandeep Chikara. So at this point, I was like, okay, you know what? I'm going to get to be in Leh, first of all. And Ladakh, Leh Ladakh is a place I've never seen before. So that will be an experience in itself. And while I'm there, I'll get to do some activity of my own. I didn't know what it would entail. Over a period of time, reading all the blogs, reading about the runner's journey, reading about some of the volunteers' journey, which are very well documented on the La Ultra website, and the links which you had also shared, and they're all on the website. I got to know that, you know what, this is serious business. Like, and I also learned that a crew does matter to a runner. So thereby I got to understand ki, okay, fine, there should, probably will be pacing involved. There'll be a lot of encouragement, taking care of runners' nutrition and everything involved. But then I probably did not see at that point the side of the, well, the side that we all learned in the crew certification course. So in terms of managing a runner's health, well, we can't manage, but then spotting signs in a runner and how we should react to it. So those were the things that I did not see beforehand and which I learned once I got to into Leh of what it all is. So yeah, the experience, all I could say was it was just not what I expected, but so much more than that.
So, you know, when you were taken through the role as a crew and your responsibilities as part of a runner's team in 222, and then you were obviously going through the crew program, you were in Leh, you were training, you could see the altitude and how difficult it is. And when you were given the added responsibility that later on you will join a runner's team in 555, did that worry you a bit much that, you know, it could push you a bit?
At no point was the worry towards me. If at all there was a worry, firstly, when I signed up with you, I signed up for the entire time. I was like, you know what, if I want to be there, I want to be there for the longest time that you are assigning. So it, definitely from the start to the end of the race. But if you tell me, please come a week before and, you know, you should also acclimatize yourself. I was like, yeah, I want to do that. So I took a whole 15-day block out of my schedule, whereby, so I was very well prepared that, you know, I want to be on the course with getting involved in one way or the other, whether be it with a runner or be it in general, but be involved with the race thoroughly and completely wherever I'm needed and contribute as much as possible throughout the race. Now, to come to the point whether I was worried, I wasn't worried on my own personal, in my own personal sense. I was worried about, okay, I want to fulfill the expectations that a runner has. So there was the... That was my only concern. Fortunately, or well, very unfortunately, Sandeep did not finish the 222 race in that. And because of that, I got this extra day off. So now, but then somewhere I was very excited, you know, when people left Nubra and we all left Nubra, here we were thinking that, oh yeah, you know what, in 12 hours, that is when we'll be required and the time starts. But then that got delayed by a day. And that day I was off. So I was very excited now. I was like, okay, now I want to do something. But then because of the challenging weather, there were now very few runners who were on the course. I think after the first night, half of the runners were already off the course. And then there was only, three races technically going on. But in that, I think in the 333 category, nobody could make the latter cutoffs. So beyond a certain time, there were actually in total only three runners on the course. So I was like, okay, somewhere or the other, I want to be involved in one way or the other. I just don't want to spend my time in doing my own thing or whatever, because I have come here for the race. And in that sense, I was very excited. And I was also really motivated to contribute in whatever way possible. So if there was a challenge, I did not face it because I had a lot of rest. I had good enough, sufficient enough time to rest. And somewhere or the other, it was more of me just thinking that, you know what, I want to do the best I can and do what is required by you. And if I'm part of a runner's team, then by the runner.
So, you know, this very important point that you said, you blocked your 15-day calendar, you came to Leh early to acclimatize. So what all activities did you do before the race? And, what all can a crew do to be better prepared before the race?
So let me just briefly backtrack. So the race started on the 17th evening, 17th of August. It was at 6 p.m. I came in on the 10th of August. 10th of August, I came in the morning, couldn't do anything. The moment I came out, I had a headache, so I couldn't do anything. But then I met you and you said, you know what, this is happened. This is normal. This happens. If it's bad, you take the Dymox and that's like this magic pill. But then I didn't need to take it. It wasn't that bad. But I was just, so I went with you to the La Ultra office. I just, sat down over there. I saw a few runners coming in. That is the first time I had an interaction with Jyotsna, with Nishchint, with Praveen. That is when I saw them. And I think the excitement had started building from that afternoon itself, because I now got to see what people are doing. The second day, again, 6 days before the race, I did a short walk to Shanti Stoop. And yeah, I was, as expected, out of breath just walking over there. So again, that was my first experience with altitude. But then all these things, as you said, were to be expected. And they were normal. So, and as the days went by, it got easier. And then I went up to Khardungla once with Sandeep sir. I went up to Varilla once with Sandeep sir. I went up with you to Varilla. We didn't go up till the top, but we touched, I think, 16,000 feet, I think, 16,000 feet. And we spent an hour or two over there. So I think being there 5 days before really helps, because you get used to that altitude. You get used to the altitude. You get used to how your day is going to be usually. And I think that was very helpful. And also, I think very crucial, because if you're expected to be active during the race, the first thing is you have to be comfortable in those conditions. And I don't think if coming a day or two before the race starts and thinking that, oh, you'll be able to crew because you don't have to do much. You just have to sit around in the car. That is not possible, because what I found was even being in the car in that altitude is uncomfortable. You are breathing heavily. You're not really well. You have a headache or something. You're just not comfortable. And the moment, I think from the point that you start being uncomfortable, then you're not able to do your assigned tasks properly. So yeah, it was very important. I think that factor was really a big advantage for me, that I came in at the day that you had prescribed, that, you know what, come in at this point if you can.
That's great. Yeah, I mean, very important points that you have touched upon. So fast forwarding it now to the race, so you joined Jason's team at about 160 kilometers at Sethi Village when he was starting his climb to Varilla. How was Jason doing at that point, and how did you plan to support him?
Okay, technically, we joined Jason at 222, but then along with Jason, I had walked up that Varilla climb the first time along with him at that time, but I was still not assigned properly to him. I think if you remember, you were at the top. You were the one who checked Jason at Varilla top, and me, myself, and T2 sir had just walked up together over there. But then at that point, so Jason was fine. I think he was looking strong. He wasn't really bothered about the weather. The conditions were really snowy, but he was running up that hill at Varilla, which was something that I couldn't do. And he was running in just his normal running shoes. He was running up through the snow. So health-wise, he was looking fine. I saw that he had some misunderstanding at that time with his team, but I thought that was no big deal. And then he finally, when he came to the 222 point, that is when, or before that, while he was making his journey down, I had already gone in the car to Sethi. And I had rested there, because at that point, I was already informed that, you know what, at 222, Jason's going to have this swap around with the crew and you guys will join him. And so, yeah, get prepared for it. So, yeah, the first thing I wanted to do was be well rested for it and be ready for it. That is when I think the excitement had just started, because that's when I got to know, okay, now I'll be with the runner. Yeah. Otherwise, till then, I think till 222, Jason made into 222 very comfortably. He was behind his own race plan, but that was more because of the delay they had on the first night when they were going up and down Khardungla. And the conditions over there were so bad that his plan or he was delayed by a few hours. Otherwise, at that point, he was fine.
What were some of the challenges in the race for you, and how did the team work around them? How important do you think is teamwork here when it comes to supporting the runner?
Extremely important. I think most part of my work was always concerned with just being with Jason. Like we are so from Triple Two, we started doing these. Alternating around, so we were myself, and at that time there was the Spanish teenager Nason, and we just took shifts of like five kilometers each to go run with Jason, set him at a pace, and keep him good. But I think the main job there was being done by so in the first leg, like from Triple Two up till Triple Three, was being done by Javi, because one thing is to keep the runner well hydrated and well fed at every kilometer, and also keep him motivated. So just keep him positive. There are times that the runner starts doubting, starts having some doubts. I mean, in Jason's case, it's I think very well documented. He even shared on a podcast, and I was there to see it. That there was this point. It was about 2 in the morning. We were around kilometer 246, 250, and we were going from Sirthi up till, 271? Lato, I think?
Lato.
Lato. So, yeah, it was in between these two points at 2 in the morning when Jason really had a bad knee. And Jason was like, you know what, I think I will not continue in this race. And the medics arrived, and Jason was concerned. He's like, okay, my knee is really hurting me. I'm not able to run. What should I do? And I think he was on the verge, and even Jason himself said that he was on the verge of saying that, you know what, I'm out of this race. But it was at that moment when, Javi came in, and he's like, you know what, Jason, I know it is bad, but I think you can make it through this pain. And you have a chance of winning the race. And I know you want to give up and you're feeling. Javi said that. And if I'm not wrong, the next 5 kilometers, Jason covered in 25 minutes, which if some of you like doing 5 kilometers in 25 minutes in a normal, I think on a race day, we'll be happy to do. And Jason was doing that from kilometer 250 of the race to kilometer 255 of the race. And that was just insane. But it is just what a small thing being said can make a huge difference. And somewhere I see that, so the biggest part of being a running crew is always knowing how and when to motivate and to make sure that we are proactive. Now, very well, the runner knows he needs food, but he will not ask for it. He is already tired. All he can think is like, he wants to go forward. So it is the crew's job to make sure he's being well fed. And if I'm not wrong, Javi kept documents whereby every kilometer, what did he eat, what did he drink, was all recorded. I think that document came out that Jason had 100 bananas or something by the end of the race. But then, and also just, mix it up. Make the younger one from Spain, so he was able to have a lot more conversations about, this one time, I think he even started, I'm not sure what he was talking about, it was really funny. I wasn't talking so much with Jason. Whenever we got into a conversation, it was more to do with running. Like I found out, I was like, Jason, so what's your marathon personal best? And he's like, I did a 2:59. And I was like, holy damn. That's like amazing and everything. So I was talking to him about strength training. I think there was this one period of 30 minutes where he gave me an entire routine of what I should do in terms of my strength training. And I think most of those exercises I'm still doing, because they are all like at home exercises. So he's like, just do like 20 sets of 10 push-ups. So that's 200 push-ups. I still can't do them, but I don't know, like Jason giving me these plans while we were running. But yeah, so your question was about the challenges a crew has. I think the biggest part is to always make sure the runner, you are doing everything to keep the runner motivated and keep him moving forward in the best possible way that he can do, and making sure that his physical ability is being maximized. And if you compromise on his food, if he is not being fed properly, or if he is not drinking enough fluids, again, he won't be running at his best. And he will not realize that. He will not come and say it to you. I want water. I think it's the crew's job to understand that, yeah, you know, he'll want the water at the next kilometer. He'll want to eat something at the next kilometer. So, yeah, that is, I think that is the biggest challenge.
So, you know, over the course, there are bound to be certain disagreements within the team, maybe, or with the runner. How do you handle those?
Okay, luckily, I personally did not face that, at least in our leg. But from all I had heard and everything is, I think the biggest key is patience. I think somewhere or the other, you have to realize that nobody is going to ever, even if something is said over there on the course, say a runner says something, it's not meant for you personally. It is just about how he's feeling. And I think anybody who's done any distance running knows that at certain points we suffer. And obviously at that point, we're not going to go out and crack a joke. Somewhere something doesn't work, we are probably going to react more strongly than usual. And I think patience at that point is the key. You just need to know that, you know, the runner is probably going through a tough phase and he'll get through it. I mean, the Edition X had put in a lot of difficult things, being weather-related, well, mostly weather-related, and that's why every runner was already behind whatever their planned schedule was. So somewhere he will probably be agitated. So it was just, I think, being more proactive at that point and making sure that, you know, you have a plan cut out. And always also, I think the team and the runner, well, the plan should be clear. If the runner has said that I want to cover the next 50 kilometers in 10 hours, you would like to keep him at that pace. You would want to keep him at that track. There is no point, and then there's no point trying to delay him in any way. Say if he stops by, and if he said that, okay, yeah, you know what, next kilometer I want a hot chocolate. Like, don't just make him come there and then he's standing there while you're preparing it. Just prepare it beforehand. So in every way, minimize the delay time. And if there is still some disagreement, you know, just handle it with a lot of patience. I think nothing is being directed at any person. It is just the nature of the race, or it is just what they're going through. I mean, it's very clear that they haven't slept for two nights. It's something I haven't done. So I don't think anybody is functioning at their 100% after doing that. And it's not just that they are just standing there for two nights without sleeping. They're actually moving about. They have ran, they've power walked. They've already gone through everything, and they know what's coming ahead is even more challenging. So I think patience is the key at those times.
So the Shreyans that landed in Leh 10 days before the race versus the Shreyans standing at the 5:55 finish, what personal transformation did you see in yourself?
When I landed in Leh, I did not know anyone for that matter, even though I had spoken to Sandeep sir, I had spoken to Manav Veya, who was also part of our crew team, and again from my same running group, but I did not know anyone. So I also, and there were people who I met, say for example, Kanchan Didi, Mukul Bhaiya, Jyotsna, who had already been to at La Ultra before. So they already know what that race was. But I didn't speak very much in the beginning because I had some reservations of my own. I thought that I don't know how helpful or how supportive people are, But then over a period of time, I realized that every single person who was there, at least who had been there before, first is out there to help, once think about himself. And that was very clear to me after 3 or 4 days. And over the course of the race, at the 5:55 finish, first of all, seeing Jason finish and then to come up behind him with the rest of the team, and how every single person was just there, out there to help everybody on the course. And it was really life-changing for me, because there were people who have taken 15 days who just are out there to help. In turn, you also realize that while helping others, you actually discover a lot more about yourself. So eventually, even though you've been there and you've helped somebody do something, you've also helped yourself achieve more. You've learned something about yourself at every step and corner. You've learned about, just by seeing the runner, you've learned that, you know what, mental barriers can be broken. And just by seeing the rest of the crew work tirelessly on the route, everybody, I think, and nobody slept properly over those 4-5 nights, be whoever he or she was, runner, crew, or everybody. But whenever you would come up to them, they wanted to help. And they were always looking for your betterment. That was definitely a big learning for me.
Next, if let's say you were to come to Laltra next, would you come back as a runner or as a crew?
I'd still crew. First of all, let's just say I know there's a 55 kilometer as well, but Laltra is not for the faint-hearted. I don't think that I am faint-hearted, but I know to qualify for the 111, you go through the Gadwal run, and I have seen the course of that run, and as of now, I even consider that to be impossible. I know everything can be achieved. One thing I have learned is nobody is limited with proper training and with the proper right motivation. Anything and everything can be achieved, but Laltra as a runner is not something that everybody just can consider as doing their first ultra event, because here you're not just fighting against the distance. Along with distance comes the altitude. And by altitude, it's just not about being over 10,000 feet. It is also about going to 18,000 and then coming back to 10 and then going back to 18 and then going back to 10. And while you're doing all that, you're also put into this phase where you're deprived of sleep. You cannot sleep for, on a course, 1 hour. And even if you get sleep, a person who will be lucky if he can just lie on the bed and fall asleep straight away, and he might get an hour. Otherwise, you don't get it. So these things, so the physical nature of the race combined with excessive hours of being awake and not sleeping, and plus the altitude makes the ultra very challenging event to run. But yeah, I would definitely want to crew, and I was mentioning it to you as well. I would love to come again this year. I love the crewing job, and I think if I'm not wrong, it was Mukul Bey had put it on the last day. When he was talking on the stage in front of everyone, he's like, a runner only finishes once, but the crew finishes the race. You get to face the happiness, or you get to experience the happiness of a runner over and over and over again as a crew member. And I think that's what makes the being a crew at La Ultra that much more special. So I would definitely love to come as a crew again. Hopefully in future, I would love to run. As of today, I don't believe I have the capacity to do it. but it's something I would like to work towards. And as I grow older, I would definitely want to qualify to run one of the distances in Lahatra.
That's great. Well, you were part of the team that made the impossible possible last year, though. Definitely very confident you'll be able to take up one of the challenges in the future. So all the best to you for that. And thank you, Shyam, for talking to us and sharing some really valuable insights about growing.
Thank you.